Welcome back, dear students. Today's class, we are going to have the continuation of limit state of collapse compression. We are going to see some of the chordal provisions regarding the limit state of compression. So you can take page number 70 in that limit state of collapse compression. You can see here clause number 39. The first one is clause number 39.1, the assumptions. In addition to the assumptions given in 38.1, A to 38.1E. You can see 38.1A is a limit state of collapse flexure. You can see this, the assumptions from A to E is valid for compression members also. The only change here happening is the maximum strain in axial compression will change. So from A to E, it will be same. We have discussed this in detail before. That is, the stresses in compression will be 0.446 FCK. All those things we have discussed. The thing that changes here is for the compressive strain in concrete in axial compression. That is, when there is axial compression, there is a uniform strain, and its maximum is 0.002. The maximum strain in compression in axial compression is 0.002. And the next one, that is, the maximum compressive strain at a highly compressed extreme fiber in a concrete subjected to an axial compression and bending, and when there is no tension on the section, shall be 0.0035 minus 0.75 times the strain at least compressed extreme fiber. This assumption number 2, you are going to study in detail in the next semester at the beginning when you are dealing with a column with axial load as well as bending in uniaxial as well as biaxial. There you are going to see a new thing, a chart or a curve called as interaction curve. While discussing that, this assumption itself is a 1 hour lecture. You need to understand it more clearly. That we will discuss in your next semester when you are dealing with the initial portion of limit state of collapse compression. There the column designed for axially loaded column with the uniaxial bending and biaxial bending. Now the second one is minimum eccentricity. All members in compression shall be designed for a minimum eccentricity in accordance with 25.4, where the calculated eccentricity is larger, the minimum eccentricity should be ignored. That is, whenever we are designing, we have studied there is a column called as axially loaded column, but in practical cases such columns are not possible, because the concrete being a heterogeneous material, we cannot say that the load which is will always act exactly through the axis of the member. So the code suggests a minimum eccentricity for every compression member. All members in the compression shall be designed for a minimum eccentricity in accordance with clause number 25.4. So if you go to clause number 25.4, you can see 25.4. says all columns shall be designed for a minimum eccentricity equal to unsupported length of the column. Here the unsupported length of the column means it is the distance from your floor to bottom of the beam or soffit of the beam. The clear distance between the floor to the bottom or soffit of the beam is called as the unsupported length of the column. That is, your E minimum or eccentricity, minimum eccentricity is equal to unsupported length of the column by 500 plus lateral dimension by 30. If you are having a B by D, this is B and this is D. If you are taking B by D, then the lateral dimension must be taken in the respective axis, subjected to a minimum of 20 mm. That is, the E minimum should be unsupported length by 500 plus lateral dimension by 30, subjected to a minimum of 20 mm. That is, this has to be every time a minimum of 20 mm. That is, the larger of these two values is taken. If it is 25 mm, we are getting this as 25 mm, then it should be 25 mm. If you are getting this value as 15 mm, then the E minimum should be 20 mm. Where biaxial bending is considered, it is sufficient to ensure that eccentricity exceeds minimum about one axis at a time. That is, if you are a, there is should if there is eccentricity greater than E minimum, then we should say that there occurs an axial loaded column with uniaxial or biaxial bending. So we will discuss one by one. Here you can see, we have discussed before the compression member definition. Column or a strut is a compression member, the effective length of which exceeds 3 times the least lateral dimension. That is, if it is less than, if the slenderness ratio is less than 3, then I can say that the thing is that it is a pedestal. If it is greater than, then it is a column or a strut. Short and slender compression members. This is short column and slender compression member means it is long column. Long column is also called as slender compression member. You can just think this long column is also called as slender compression member. A compression member may be considered as short when both the slenderness ratio, that is in your x-axis, LEX by D, and this and is very important, and LEY by B are less than 12. That is less than, it's less than and E or equal to, okay. But most of the cases we will discuss with less than. When LEX by D, that is your slenderness ratio in the x-axis, and LEY by B, that is your slenderness ratio in the y-axis, if both are less than 12, then I can call this one as a short column. And the second one is, it shall otherwise be considered as a slender compression member. That is LEX by D or LEY by B. That is, in any axis, if it is greater than 12, then the column is called as a long column. This we have discussed in the last lecture, where LEX is the effective length in respect of the major axis. D is the depth in respect of the major axis. Here, we always consider the major axis as X axis is always considered as the major axis. Then LEY, effective length in respect to the minor axis, that is your Y axis, and B is the width of the member. Now, the unsupported length of the member, as I have told you, you just need to understand there is the distance, clear distance between the floor and bottom of your beam. So, bottom of the beam is also called as soffit of the beam. Now, the LEX value, that is the effective length value, you will get it from page number 94, Annex C. You will get it from Annex C. We have discussed that also. Now, we will again go to page number. So, now we have discussed with a minimum eccentricity. Now you take clause number 26.5.3, that is columns. First one, 26.5.3.1, that is longitudinal reinforcement. The cross-sectional area of longitudinal reinforcement shall not be less than 0.8% nor more than 6% of the gross area of the column. That is, for a column, the minimum area of reinforcement is 0.8% of the gross cross-sectional area, and the maximum is 6%. That is, AST minimum is 0.8% and AST maximum is 6%. The use of 6% reinforcement may involve practical difficulties in placing and compacting of the concrete, because the 6% is very much high, such that we cannot pour the concrete inside after the formwork is being laid. Hence, lower percentage is recommended. We will not go up to 6%. When bars from the columns below have to be lapped with those in the column under consideration, the percentage of steel shall usually not exceed 4%. That is, when we are providing the lapping, that is, suppose we have finished one column, the next column starts, before that we will provide some lapping or development in order to attain the development length, or in order to attain the proper transfer of the load, we will provide certain lapping length. If lapping is provided, then the maximum area of steel that should be provided is 4%. So keep in mind, in normal circumstances it is 6%, and if lapping is provided, it is 4%. You can see here, clause number, you can see here the maximum reinforcement. This is called as lapping. See, here one column is there, the next column starts here. When the next column starts, the reinforcement from the bottom column is going above up to certain length, and the next column reinforcement starts from here. So this is called as lapping. That is, the main reinforcement from here, these are the main reinforcements. It is green and this blue are the main reinforcement. The reinforcement goes up to certain length. So this is called as lapping. When lapping is provided, the maximum area does not exceed 4%. If lapping is not provided, it should be 6%, and the AST minimum is 0.8%. The next one, in any column that has a larger cross-sectional area than required to support the load, the minimum percentage of steel shall be based upon the area of concrete required to resist the direct stress and not upon the actual area. This is because due to architectural consideration, suppose the architect says that I want a big column there for the aesthetical appearance, I want a big column there, but actually that much big column is not required there. So what we do is we will simply design it for a smaller length column, and we will provide the casing or simply concrete it around it such that it looks like a bigger column. So when you are taking the minimum area of steel, we need to consider the actual area that we have considered. It's not the projected or it is not the shown area. That is, the shown area due to architectural consideration will be very big. It's not that we should show it. The next one, the minimum number of longitudinal bars provided in a column shall be 4 in rectangular columns and 6 in circular columns. That is, if you are providing rectangular columns, the minimum number of bars should be 4, and if it is a circular column, it should be 6. Keep in mind, these things are very much required. The bar shall not be less than 12 mm in diameter. That is, if you are providing the bar for a column, it should not be less than 12 mm. There is some consideration when the width of the section is very much less. We will discuss that later. But normally, the bar shall not be less than 12 mm in diameter for a column. The reinforced column, concrete column having helical reinforcement shall have at least 6 bars of longitudinal reinforcement with the helical reinforcement. That is, the longitudinal reinforcement should be at least 6 bars for a helical reinforced column. In helical reinforced column, the longitudinal bar shall be in contact with the helical reinforcement and the equidistance around its inner circumferences. The spacing of the longitudinal bars measured along the periphery of the column shall not exceed 300 mm. That is, the distance between your a main reinforcement, a longitudinal bar should not exceed 300 mm. That is, when you are taking the distance along the periphery of the column, if it is a circular column, along the perimeter, and if the square column also along the perimeter, if you are taking the distance, should not exceed 300 mm between the longitudinal bars. In case of pedestal in which the longitudinal reinforcement is not taken into account in strength calculation, the nominal longitudinal reinforcement shall not be less than 0.15% of the cross sectional area. This we have discussed before. That is, in case of pedestal, we normally design it in as a PCC, but a minimum reinforcement of 0.1% of the total cross sectional area should be provided for pedestal. You can see here, pedestal is a compression member, the effective length of which does not exceed 3 times the least lateral dimension, which I discussed. Now, about the transverse reinforcement, we will see here. We need to see mainly this one, the pitch and diameter of the lateral ties. The pitch means the distance between two successive lateral ties. The pitch of transverse reinforcement shall not be more than least of the following distances. The first one, the least lateral dimension of the compression member. If you are having 300 by 500, then the least lateral dimension is 300. Then 16 times the smaller diameter of the longitudinal reinforcement bar to be tied. 16 times the smallest diameter of the longitudinal bar. Suppose I am providing 28 mm bar and 20 mm bar as the longitudinal or the main reinforcement. Then the pitch should not exceed 16 times the diameter of the smaller bar, and providing 28 as well as 20. So the smallest means what? It will be 20. That is 16 times 20. It should not exceed 16 times 20 or 300 mm, which means the distance between the lateral ties should not be more than the least lateral dimension of the compression member, or 16 times 5 main small, or 300 mm, whichever is smaller. The next one, the diameter. The diameter of the polygonal links or lateral ties shall not be less than 1/4 of the diameter of the largest longitudinal bar. That is, if I am taking 20 mm and 28 mm, it should not be less than 1/4 of 28. It should not be less than 1/4 of 28, and in no case less than 6 mm. This is a caudal mistake. You should change it. This is actually 6 mm. In no case it should be less than 6 mm. Okay, please change it. And helical reinforcement we will discuss when we are dealing with the circular column with helical reinforcement, and this is actually used for the detailing. That also we'll discuss when we are required, when there is a detailing part, detailing part, when we are discussing the detailing part of your column. So these are the caudal provisions that you need to know before the design of a column. So coming to here, we have discussed this one. Now we'll have a small recap of what you have studied. This is the case of minimum reinforcement and maximum reinforcement. So you can see here, this is the lapping going to be given for the next column. One column has stopped here. When you are starting the next column, this will act as a lapping. So the minimum area of steel, this is a recap of what you have said. The minimum, this you need to by heart, you need to, this can be asked for your Viva, this can be asked for you when you are going for interviews, etc. The minimum area of steel for a column is 0.8% of the total cross-sectional area. The maximum area of steel is 6% of the total cross-sectional area when laps are not provided, and 4% of the total cross-sectional area when lapping is provided. The minimum number of bars used for a column, when it is circular, it is 6 numbers, and if it is rectangular, it is 4 numbers. The maximum diameter of bar, sorry, the minimum diameter of the bar is 12 mm, and the spacing of the main reinforcement should not be along the periphery, it should not be greater than 300 mm. Diameter of the lateral ties, either 5 main divided by 4 or 6 mm. Here 5 main means the largest should be taken, or 6 mm, whichever is more. Pitch of the lateral ties, that is the distance between the lateral ties, it should be either least lateral dimension or 16 times smallest diameter or 300 mm, whichever is more. The minimum eccentricity, E minimum, according to clause number 25.4, you have E minimum is equal to L divided by 5, unsupported length divided by 500 plus lateral dimension divided by 30 or 20 mm, whichever is more. This is a general case. Suppose I am having, this is a general case, that is that the beam along this direction and along this direction is having same width. Suppose you can see here, is having same, the depth of the beam is same. Suppose I am having a beam like this. This is your x-axis, this is your y-axis. For the x-axis, the lateral dimension is d. Lateral means perpendicular dimension. Lateral dimension is d. For the y-axis, the lateral dimension is b. So I can say, if I am taking along the x-axis and y-axis, if the beams are having different depth, then the unsupported length will also be different. You can see here, suppose I am placing, assume that there is a column here. This is beam A and this is beam B. This is having different length, right? The depth of the beam A is different when compared to depth of the beam B. So if there is a column over here, the unsupported length along the x-axis is from the bottom of the floor, top of the floor to bottom of this beam. That is unsupported length along the x direction, and unsupported length along the y direction will be what? From top of the floor to bottom of this beam. So that will be different. That is unsupported length in x axis will be different, unsupported length in y axis will be different when the beam is having different. That is beam A, there is one beam A and beam B. Though those are having different dimensions, then definitely the unsupported length is also going to have different dimension. At that case we need to consider E minimum along the x direction as well as E minimum along the y direction. Then I will take minimum eccentricity, that is E minimum xx along the x direction as L0x, that is the unsupported length divided along the x direction divided by 500 plus lateral dimension. Here the lateral dimension is D divided by 30 or 20 mm, whichever is more. And in the y direction, it will be E minimum yy is L0y, that is unsupported length divided by 500 plus lateral dimension. Here for y axis, the lateral dimension is capital B, okay? Capital B divided by 30 or 20 mm, whichever is more. So if the unsupported length is different along the axis, we need to consider the E minimum separately and we need to calculate accordingly. So the unsupported length, you will get it like this. Now, the design of a short column. This we will discuss in the next class. Hope you are clear up to here. Thank you, students. Thank you and have a nice day.